We are experiencing temporary problems with the audio portion of our telecast. We will continue with the video portion of the program and hope to have the problem corrected shortly. Please stand by.
A profit. A couple of weeks ago, you said the guys didn't have their clocks wound right. This is usually their opener.
Now there's no time for alibis, Brian. Nothing to fall back on. But Cleveland has one built in. We have just found out that Greg Pruitt, their star running back, will be out for today's contest as they go for three in a row against the Atlanta Falcons.
Okay, before we get into today, let's clean up yesterday. They call him Alexander the Great down south. His name is Charles Alexander. He's a Heisman Trophy candidate. And last night, he led the Bayou Bengals of LSU to a 24-17 win over the Indiana Hoosiers. Michael, he's something else. He's got 144 yards and two touchdowns, 215 pounds.
Well, Brian, he is the best thing to happen to LSU and Charlie McClendon since Burt Jones. And he is also making, and it's really tough to do, he's making fans forget Billy Cannon, the great LSU legend.
There was another big debut yesterday. Art Schleister, the freshman of Ohio State, but it was a losing effort at Columbus, 19-0, the Nittany Lions. When was the last time Woody put the ball in the air 30 times?
I don't think since Wallace Berry played Tugboat Annie. And he also started a freshman, which is really very rare for Woody Hayes.
Other scores. The Mike Ford leads the SMU Mustangs, and they've got a football team. Just ask the Gators. 10-point differential in Florida. And Air Force sprang a surprise at Chestnut Hill. They beat BC. The final count on that one was 18-7. Let's change it up just a little bit and go to baseball. The four contenders in the American League met in two crucial games deciding divisional battles yesterday. Right here, the Yankees beat the Boston Red Sox 3-2, continuing the Red Sox late season collapse. It was 2-2 in the ninth inning when Mickey Rivers led off against Mike Torres with a triple up the alley. Before Gary Hancock could chase it down when the ball had rolled to a stop, Mick the Quick had rounded second and cruised on into third to provide the Yankees with a lead run and nobody out. With the infield drawn in, Thurman Munson picked on a 1-2 pitch, looped it into right center, and Jimmy Rice did all he could with it. He caught it, but certainly it wasn't enough for the Red Sox. Mickey Rivers cruised home, giving the Yankees a 3.5 game lead in the American East. That's the same lead the Kansas City Royals hold over the Angels today in the American West. The Angels pulled a come from behind yesterday. They were down 3-1 in the eighth inning, facing Al Roboski. Carney Lansford, the batter with two men on, he takes Roboski up and over the wall in left center to provide the Angels with a 4-3 lead they'd never relinquish. Were the Royals and Roboski mad? I guess. Watch this one. First pitch, a message to Lyman Bostock. He says, that's cool. That's part of the game, but this one is not. Not behind my head. You and me, on the mat we will go. And on the mat they did go. Roboski against Bostock. Everybody joined in. Typical baseball fight, though. A lot of shoving, a lot of pushing, a lot of ejections, and absolutely no one was hurt. And the baseball races will continue today, and you'll be able to see it right here on NFL 78. We'll be bringing you highlights of the Red Sox-Yankees affair as they try to decide the title in the American League East. We'll get back to football, and we'll do it by looking at a controversy right after this. Unless you have spent the last week living in a cave, you would have heard football fans this week talking about the officiating. And Michael, the first bad call that people have been talking about occurred in San Diego last week. How do you feel as a player when it happens?
Well, if you're a player, Brian, you're very frustrated, especially if you're a San Diego Charger and dominate a team the way the Chargers did Oakland. But I think what all players would like to see is that the NFL officiating position become full-time year-round.
All right, let's turn back the clock a little bit to last Sunday. The Chargers are leading 20-14. There are only seconds left in the ball game. We get the call, as it happened, from our Jim Simpson.
Bradshaw wide to the right. Stabler back to throw. Stabler now being harassed for the first time. It gets rid of the ball. Ball is loose. Still loose. Picked up. Kick into the end zone. And we'll see what happens. There's something. Touchdown. Can you believe it? Touchdown Raiders.
Our film really doesn't show it all that plainly, but the videotape we got shows it very plainly. Low is has Stabler in his grasp. Stabler's facing our goal line. Lowe's pushing him back. He left-handed, underhand, threw the ball forward about 5.5 yards. And
everybody's asking me about, well, did you throw it, did you try to lateral it, did you pass it, or what'd you do? I don't, you know, you just do something, you know, you don't have anything in mind. And then the referee calls it. I mean, yeah, you can't, you don't plan anything like that. The only thing in my mind was don't get sacked with the ball, because if you do, the game's over. 10 seconds left, no timeouts. If you get sacked, so I didn't want to keep the ball.
It was very obvious that Kenny Stabler threw the ball underhanded. He threw it forward. He admitted it in the newspapers. In interviews, he said that he deliberately fumbled forward. That should have been ruled an incompleted forward pass.
I can only say that when you look at the film, I think it's in the eye of the beholder.
Then Banaszak recovered the ball, got it in both hands, and he threw it forward about 8 yards.
And we broke the huddle over 10 seconds left. So, you know, if I pick the ball up, he tackles me and the ball game's over there anyway. Yeah, I mean, I knew what the game situation was, you know. And I just, you know, hit it and drove the goal line.
Banaszak, their fullback, picked up the ball and heaved it, threw it toward the San Diego goal line.
I can only say, in looking at the film, I did not think it was so clear that it was a blatant error by an official in judgment not to have called it. I wish it had been called, but I certainly would not say that it was a blatant error. It was close enough that I could understand why it wasn't called.
Casper juggled it into the end zone and recovered it, and the officials ruled a touchdown.
I believe it was an atrocious series of calls, and I hope that the NFL responds to my protest.
But there will be no response to Klein's protest because there's no protest procedure in the NFL. Question is, should there be?
It might be that a provision for protest should be put in the rules for certain specific things that might occur. And I think it will be discussed at our annual meeting in March.
On the night after that call was made in San Diego, there was another controversial call. This one occurred in Minnesota, and it also could have decided a game. Michael, I understand you backed the officials with this one.
Bryant, there was two consecutive calls. The initial one was correct. Don Wedge signaled that Weiss was tackled behind the line of scrimmage, and of course, the clock stops.
As we watch it, let's take a look. Perhaps the culprit is Nate Allen of the Vikings, who picked up the ball and stopped Wedge from actually allowing the play to continue. Let's pick it up. Weiss is in charge of the offense. The Broncos are trailing by 3 points when he rolls out, viewed as a passer by Wedge. How did the Broncos get their kicking team on the field? Here's a possible explanation.
In Minnesota, they have a unique situation. It's the only stadium we have wherein both teams are on the same side of the field. So this occurred virtually in front of the Denver bench. And Denver only had to get 4 substitutes in for their kicking team. The official took a new ball over to the hash mark, put it down. Players were there. He signaled the play to start, and the snap of the center occurred prior to time expiring, so the play was still live, and the field goal was kicked.
And so it is that names like Wedge and Mark Wright have replaced Staubach and Jones as the most talked about names in the NFL. We'll continue to look at the referees, and next week, John Brody will have a commentary on officiating in the NFL. Perhaps it is the officials are overmatched. Speaking of overmatched, my friend here spent the week with some cheerleaders. I know you won't want to miss it after this. I've got to be honest with you. It says right here that I am supposed to, at this point, lead into a cheerleader feature, but instead I've got a question, which is, how did you get the assignment?
Brian, how quickly you forget. You lost a toss. You don't remember that. You know, cheerleading is as much a part of the NFL as the forward pass, but it's not all tinsel and glamour. There's a lot of hard work, as I found out earlier.
They're called the Dallas Cowboy Cheerleaders, and they started it all. That's not to say they were the first, because most NFL teams have had cheerleaders for some time. But the Cowboys 36 made cheerleading big business, and even the most diehard of football fans will have to admit, cheerleading is here to stay.
Yeah, but don't touch, baby. 1, 2.
In Chicago, the Honey Bears have listed as many oohs and ahs as does Walter Payton. And for hours a night, several nights a week, these girls learn and rehearse strictly choreographed dance routines and cheers, which they showcase on Sunday afternoon.
Patty, what prompts a girl to become a cheerleader? You do this for very little money and a lot of long hours of practice. How come?
Well, first of all, I've always liked football. I'm a diehard Bear fan. I like football. I love football. And I was a cheerleader in high school. I love football. I think, first of all, you have to have a basic love for football. I have even gotten more involved in football. I think that we're an inspiration to the team.
Because I am a cheerleader at heart.
After playing in the NFL and demonstrating limited coordination on the playing field, I wanted to see if I could play ball with the pros on the sidelines.
Ladies, I'm just a dumb football player, and I had trouble when I played chewing gum and walking or running at the same time. Can I learn this at all?
You sure can.
Really?
Yeah, anybody can.
Oh, show me.
Sure. And after a few minutes of instruction, I was ready to join the chorus line.
Okay, I think I've had enough. Talk about the ultimate in participatory journalism. George Plimpton, eat your heart out. Heaven.
At the risk of getting thrown off the air, getting thrown out of the house by June Gumbel, Michael, I am speechless.
I don't think John Travolta has to worry, Brian, but I'd like to deliver a special plaudit to our cameraman, Barry Winnick, who in the face of all that pawkertude was able to hold his hand oh so steady.
Somehow or other, I'm supposed to make a smooth transition from that to what I've got to do, but we'll try it anyway. As part of NBC's continuing coverage leading up to the Moscow Games of 1980, we're going to be bringing you Olympic moments about what has happened and what is happening in the Olympic movement. As part of that, we take time out right now to bring you this Olympic moment.
This Olympic moment is brought to you by the Bell System. When it comes to solving business communications problems, the system is the solution.
Helsinki, 1952. The opening day ceremonies of the 15th Olympiad. The following day, the final of the 10,000-meter run. The favorite in the race, Emil Zatopek, a major in the Czechoslovakian army. The runners will travel the 400-meter track 25 times. At the end of 25 laps, Zatopek has lapped nearly every runner in the race. He wins the gold medal and breaks the Olympic record. 2 days later, the final of the 5,000-meter run. With 200 meters to go, Emil Zatopek is in fourth place. He starts his final sprint. Emil Zatopek first. He wins his second gold medal. On the last day of competition, Emil Zatopek enters the 26-mile, 385-yard marathon. It is the first time he has ever run in this event. In a little more than 2 hours, Zatopek is the first man into the stadium. Emil Zatopek, the only man in Olympic history to win the classic long-distance events, the 10,000 meters, 5,000 meters, and historic marathon run.
We spoke earlier of the disappointment the Chargers experienced last Sunday, but the fact that the San Diego Chargers can experience disappointment, Mike, is an indication that they are indeed back.
It's a good sign, Brian. There are no patsies in the AFC West, and if you look at young talent, San Diego may have the best.
I say back because the Chargers in the old days of the AFL were a championship team. But since the merger, they fell on hard times, lost a lot, went through a drug scandal, but they are back, certainly in the mind of owner Gene Klein.
We went through the birth pains. We went through the agony of losing 11 straight games a couple of years years ago, before we won our first game, we played the rookies, the youngsters.
You know, I don't think it would have been much fun to be here when the Chargers were going through the bad years with, you know, they had the big scandal and stuff.
When the Chargers won the AFL title in 1963, the lineup was star-studded. One was the great receiver Hall of Famer Lance Allworth. He still watches, this time from the safety of the stands.
We were winners, and we knew we could win. And I just feel like that the guys that are coming in now and the team that that they're putting together now are starting to feel that way. In fact, with the addition of Mitchell, I was hoping with the leader that he is, that they will get more of a feeling from him even, and that maybe we'll get them over the hump, because that's all they need is just a little something.
Somewhat reminds me of the 75 Baltimore Colts. We were young, we didn't know what winning was all about, and still this team doesn't know what winning is all about until you get out there and you experience winning 3 or 4 or 5 or 6 games in a row. And then you know that you're a good football team. You go out and you say, well, we know we can win each week.
The first move that was made was the hiring of Tommy Prothrow, who has done a magnificent job both in coaching and perhaps more importantly in gathering the talent and selecting the talent for this club.
We've been very fortunate in the draft. I think we've made a few good trades. And I think our players have developed, and I think we're very competitive.
What's encouraging the Charger fans now is not just that the team is competitive right now, but has great young stars like number 83 rookie John Jefferson.
He has an amazing talent, and his presence on that field means an awful lot to the Chargers offense, even if when they don't throw it to him. He's a tremendous athlete. I enjoy watching him.
He is certainly the most outstanding young receiver I've ever seen.
In 1975, we drafted 8 players who are starters or are on our team today. The trades helped us. The 1978 draft has given us John Jefferson, one of the outstanding players in the game. You can see in the players the excitement, the anticipation, the pulling together and the doing it. And we know that 1978 is the beginning of Charger time.
We'll be watching the continuing progress of the Chargers today as they go against last year's Cinderella team, the Denver Broncos, today in another big AFC Western matchup. We're getting close to kickoff time. Down on the field, they're just about ready. NFL 78 will go down to the field after these messages from your local station.